Hi, welcome to Freezer Meals 101. I'm Christy.
And I'm Sharla. And today we are just filling our freezer with kind of some random things.
Yeah, you could call it a hodgepodge, but there's a method to our madness. Sometimes it's just really necessary to, you know, you open up your freezer and you see gaps, sometimes literal, sometimes metaphorical.
Yes.
And you're thinking, I don't have enough for breakfast, or there's not enough snacks, or how did we go through all of that chicken already?
Yeah, and so then you need to fill up where, you know, those spaces that you need filled. So we're just bringing you along today in the journey.
And come see our weird hodgepodge mishmash of meals that we are putting together for us and for you.
So we're going to explain a little bit more about that in a bit, but we thought that we would jump right into our first recipe today. We're actually going to get started with a weird one, which is a side dish, and it is Parmesan Brussels sprouts. And I'm going to Christy explain why we're going to start with that one.
We made this one a little while ago when we did our mega meal session. Mm-hmm. And over Christmas, I got an air fryer.
Actually, we have air fryer.
We do.
Air fryer recipes.
Yeah, we have air fryer recipes.
All air fryer recipes. You can look at them there.
Absolutely. More specifically, my husband got the air fryer because he has been bugging me for 2 years. And I'm like, honey, we don't need another appliance. Honey, I don't know. Do we need an air fryer? Well, I got him the air fryer. And so now we are air fryer people. And let me tell you, it is life-changing. You should get an air fryer. So I made the Brussels sprouts that we had made in our last mega meal session. And it had the Parmesan cheese mixed right into it, which was good if you're going to do it in the oven. But to do it in the air fryer, it unfortunately dripped down. You know, I don't know if you know how I didn't know this about an air fryer. There's a little rack in the bottom, and it just dripped down into it. And so I had to sprinkle more Parmesan cheese. So I told Charla, I'm like, it's awesome, we have to do this, but we're gonna change it up a little bit for the air fryer. We're gonna put the Parmesan cheese in a separate bag and we'll sprinkle it on when there's like a couple of minutes left, and then it'll brown and it'll crisp. And yes, some of it's gonna drip down below, but it'll do a better job of sticking to the Brussels sprouts, I think. So we're gonna try it again.
So in our bag, we're gonna put just some frozen Brussels sprouts. It is so easy. A splash of olive oil, 2 cloves of minced garlic. We like to use the jarred minced garlic because it's faster and easier and just saves us a little bit of time. Some salt and pepper. Now, normally you would put 1/4 cup of Parmesan cheese right there in your bag and then sprinkle some more on at the end. Mm-hmm. But for today, because these are specifically for the air fryer, we are going to do the Parmesan cheese. We'll really do a little more than 1/4 cup because it's all going on at the end. And we'll put that in a medium-sized freezer bag, and we're gonna staple that to our other freezer bag. Get the air out of both, because of course, you never want air because that's what causes your freezer burn. That was lickety-split. One of the reasons that we are doing meals today is because next week, my family and I are going on a ski trip in the mountains. We always look forward to going. I don't personally ski, although I might take lessons this year, so that could change.
No, look at you.
I know. Can you imagine?
Yes, skiing? I can. Well, not you specifically, but our neighbor up the hill growing up, we took her for the first time ever when she was 70 years old.
Whoa!
She was like your mom. She was the Energizer Bunny. She walked every day. She was healthy. And we were going, and she said, you know, I've never done that. And she talked like that. Her name was, oh my gosh, we called her Auntie Sheehan because, you know, she was living up the hill and she was at our house every day. So, I've never done that. I should go with you. And so, you know, 6 a.m, we picked up Auntie Sheehan and took her to the hill. And it was just a little hill. It wasn't a big mountain, but she learned and she did it. It was really
great. That's kind of awesome.
So if she can do it, you can do it.
I think I can do it.
But of course you can do it.
It might not be this trip that I take the lessons, so I'm not going to be able to report back right away. But sometime this year, I might take lessons. normally, while my family is out skiing, I either read or work on the computer, and then when they come in, I feed them. But I like it to feel like a vacation for me too. So I bring lots of crockpot things. I have a crockpot that I use. And so I'm bringing chili, which we've made already. We did that when we did our winter freezer meals. I'm bringing a Dr. Pepper pulled pork.
Oh, good one.
Because like my nieces and nephews and, you know, brother-in-law and sister-in-law, well, several of my brother-in-laws and sister-in-laws and stuff are going to be up there at the same time.
And goes so a long way. That's a good one.
That spreads so far because you can put it like with your coleslaw and your buns and it just, and it's huge. Like, so it feeds a crowd.
Yeah.
So I've got that happening, but I also need some other things. I want to bring soup because it's
skiing, you know, it's skiing in the winter, yeah, in the mountains.
And then I'm going to talk about that in a second, about this, like why I chose these two recipes that we're doing. But anyway, but I also want to do waffles so that my kids can quickly just put them in the toaster and, you know, the freezer to toaster, and then, and I don't have to think about breakfast. And then I have a lot of like teens and young adults, and so they eat. And when they're exercising, they especially eat. And so we're going to make chicken taquitos. Because A, great late night snack for my hungry skiers, and B, air fryer.
Air fryer!
Okay, so I want to tell you about this soup casserole business that I got happening, and then I'll jump into those recipes. But the soup that I'm going to bring is a pizza soup, which we've never made before.
We've never made. It sounds super weird.
I think it sounds weird too, and I personally am going to make some quesadillas to bring for myself, so I'm not going to eat the pizza soup, but my family, like, it's a very kid-friendly soup.
They'll let you know.
Soup, and
they'll let you know.
They will let me know if it's good or not, but the bag of pepperoni slices that I have to buy is, like, it's too much for the pizza soup, so I invented this, like, tortellini pizza casserole that I know will
Smart.
Be good.
Yes.
Often when we go to the mountains, we bring either tortellini soup or the tortellini sausage skillet. You can find that recipe in the Freezer Meals 101 Club. It's so hearty.
It's so,
so good.
And it's so fast.
It's,
it just zips together.
And so great to bring, again, on vacation because you don't want to have to actually cook.
No.
And so I thought tortellini, hearty, stick to your bones a little bit, and so, but then I'm going to use the other half of the bag of the pepperoni slices and make it in this tortellini casserole business pizza-y thing, which again is kid-friendly. So
good. You're so clever. Or if you bought two bags, then you could just make two of each.
Which would be...
You have four freezer meals.
Perfect. So, pizza soup. Again, weird.
We'll see. We'll see. I'm not sold. I am going to need personal feedback from your children.
And she knows how picky my kids are, so they say they like it.
Yeah, no. They'll like it. I'm sure. I like pizza. And I like soup. It might be hearty enough for me to have without a bun.
I doubt it. Actually, for this one, you can put croutons on top.
Oh, I
so
would.
So then, yeah. Exactly.
That'd be awesome.
In your large freezer bag, we're adding 4 ounces of sliced pepperoni, 4 slices of bacon that's been cooked and crumbled.
It's starting out really good, by the way.
Right?
Yeah.
Bacon, pepperoni.
Yeah.
So
pizza.
Then we've got some garlic. Again, we're just using our jarred minced garlic. And then 24 ounces of pizza sauce, or you can substitute the red sauce from the club for the pizza sauce to get it to be a little more flavorful. A teaspoon of oregano, some pepper, 1/2 green pepper that's been diced. And, you know, so I went ahead and when I invented that other casserole,
guess what?
I
it's
put
got
the
green
other
pepper
half
in
of
it.
The green pepper
of
in
course
it,
he
right? Because then if you're going to do the work, you might as well make two
yes,
meals,
yeah.
right? And then an onion that's minced and 3 cups of beef broth. Now, you can either put the beef broth directly in the bag now, or you can have it in your pantry so that you can add it later. because I'm taking this with us on the ski trip, I'm going to put it right in the bag so that I don't have to think about, you know, making sure I remember to bring the beef broth with us. And then in a medium size bag, you're going to put a cup of shredded mozzarella cheese and staple that above the seal to your other bag so that on the day you serve this, if you want, you can top it with croutons and you also top it with that shredded mozzarella cheese.
Mm, that sounds really good.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, I could try this one. This is good.
Yeah, I spent quite a bit of time yesterday inventing recipes and figuring out, like, you know, what sounds like a ski trip meal.
That's totally ski
trip. Kid-friendly and, you know, yeah, all the things.
Pizza soup.
Because I want this to be as easy on me as it possibly can be.
It's like going camping. You know, yes, it's a vacation, but sometimes for the cook, it's not a vacation. It's still a lot of work to go do those things.
You bring freezer meals, mm-hmm, and then it's
so much easier.
But this is like, it's a 7-hour drive there, 7-hour mm-hmm drive back, and then once we're there, again, they're really hungry. They eat a lot. They also get really excited, so we bring lots of board games. It's nice. It's like cozy because mm-hmm you have that board game time, but I want to make it as easy as possible.
You want to play board games too?
I do.
Yeah.
I want to get a break too. And I want it to feel like a vacation. So the other thing that we are making with those other ingredients that we've already prepped, so we might as well just make another meal, is
pizza tortellini bake. You're going to start out with your bag and you can add a 1-pound pack of cheese tortellini. Now, the Costco ones are 900 grams, which is like 2 pounds. So did you know?
Oh, so we should make two of these at a time.
Well, are you only planning on using half a bag of it?
I wasn't really doing the math.
No.
Because, you know, math is not my strong suit.
But it's 2 pounds, just so you know.
Well, I could either double it.
So we either call this 2 pounds.
Giant family. Or we could make two. Or I could invent, I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna invent another soup, a chicken tortellini soup.
Okay.
With the other half of that bag, because I have some carrots in the freezer.
Okay.
And today we're doing a hodgepodge, so we're also going to make a chicken tortellini soup. So stay tuned for that recipe. We're just gonna do things as we go.
This is how my life is. This is how her brain works, and this is how my life is. I poke holes in things, and then she comes up with solutions. If only everybody could have friends like that. No, that's awesome. That's a great idea.
Right?
Okay, so we're gonna stick with the 1 pound.
Yes.
So that means it's half your container.
Yeah, and then we're gonna put the other half of the Costco bag in another bag to make
your chicken tortellini.
Chicken tortellini right soup.
Back to the bag.
Yes.
We have our freezer bag. We're going to put in half a container from the Costco one. You can find the 900 gram containers at the grocery store too. So 1 pound of the cheese tortellini, add in 2 cups of pizza sauce
or the
red sauce from the club, half a cup of minced onion because we're already mincing onions, the other half of that green pepper that we mentioned in the first recipe, well, the second recipe, a can of sliced olives that's been drained. It's just the little guys, right? Just the little can, the 2.25 ounce. 4 ounces of pepperoni slices, and then a cup of mozzarella, and then optional, you could put in half a cup of sliced mushrooms in here because it's pizza. Mushrooms go on pizza.
Some people like mushrooms on their pizza, yeah.
That's my favorite pizza in the world is pepperoni mushroom. It's so simple, but it's like, and nobody in my family wants to eat that, so it's just me. So in a separate bag, we're going to also put another cup of mozzarella. And then you're going to squeeze all the air out, you're going to staple these together, and then on the day of cooking, you want to thaw them, put it in a casserole dish, and sprinkle that second bag of mozzarella on top. And you want to bake it at 375 for about 50 minutes while it's covered. And then uncover, and you can bake for another 10 minutes. That sounds awesome.
Doesn't that sound great?
Yeah.
And now we get to make another soup.
And then we get another soup, and it sounds like a good one. Your brain.
Okay,
what's
so,
next?
Well, we might as well do that soup, right?
Do you want to write it down?
As I talk.
As you're doing it? Why don't I get you a pen? You can edit that out later if you're not feeling it. This is where the magic happens, folks.
All right.
Okay, we're ready. So, she's done the work.
The tortellini soup is going to be the other half of that giant pack of tortellini, cheese tortellini, an onion chopped, some minced garlic, because of course, garlic in everything. Then we are going to do about half to 1 cup of frozen spinach.
Oh yeah.
Right?
Chopped or not?
Chopped. 1 cup of carrots, peeled and sliced. 1 teaspoon of Italian seasoning, a bay leaf, salt and pepper, and a Tetra Pak, which is 4 cups
yes.
of chicken broth. That's it. Now we have...
That sounds delicious.
Chicken
tortellini. Actually, it does sound delicious.
Oh, I forgot the chicken. And I forgot to mention that we're also adding... Cooked, one cup of cooked, shredded or cubed chicken.
I would do cubed in this for sure. But if you have shredded, it would totally work.
Okay, I have to add that to the recipe. See, I have to write it down as I go here, because if it's really delicious, then we need to add it to the club.
And
I won't remember what
we've
I put
done
in.
This. We've gone back and watched videos before of
yes.
what did I put in that? You had to recreate the paneer curry.
Yes, I did.
And it was still good.
It was. I don't know if
paneer
it was
curry?
As good as the
was
first
it?
Time.
Yeah, it was.
But, you know.
It was good. I've made it again since.
Okay, so here, we invented a recipe on the fly. Because it's fill your freezer day.
And it's a hodgepodge.
We're just doing whatever. Whatever we feel like. Okay, and this next recipe is going to be really good for your air fryer and for my hungry teens, which is our chicken taquitos.
This is chicken taquitos. We have done this before, but it's been many years.
Yeah, I did it last year.
Oh, you did for you, yeah.
For snacks for the kids,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
It's been a long time since our family has done these, and they are so good. So we start out with 2 to 3 cups of cooked, shredded rotisserie chicken. So you know the rotisserie chicken that you buy at the grocery store?
Ooh.
We have
if
a video.
If you don't know how to shred those and like get as much meat off as possible, we have a video where Christy teaches me, because I didn't know how to do it.
That's
well.
Right.
So she teaches me. We did like 6 or something.
Yeah, I don't know if we did it, if I did it well, but we got it done.
Yeah.
I got as much meat off that chicken that was going...
Yes.
To come off. Yeah. No, it's good. So go watch that.
She has a system.
I have a system. Come back here and make your taquitos. So we have our 2 to 3 cups of shredded rotisserie chicken, 8 ounces of cream cheese.
That's been softened.
That's been softened. 3 tablespoons of cilantro. That's been chopped. 2 tablespoons of lime juice. A couple of cloves. I can't talk today. A couple of cloves of minced garlic. A can of green chilies. Some cumin, some chili powder, some salt, and some shredded jalapeno cheese. And so we're gonna mix these all together in the bowl. That's why your cream cheese needs to be softened, because you're kind of making a filling, right? And it's a bit of a good mixture. It's a good, nice, solid texture. It's heavy, it's good. But then we're gonna roll them up into these tiny little flour tortillas. So we take our flour tortilla and we're going to roll it. And then when we're going to put it on our cookie sheet to freeze, because we're going to freeze these flat first, and then we're going to add them to the bag. That way they won't stick together.
Yeah.
When you put them on the cookie sheet, make sure that seam is down on the bottom. They'll stay flat and sealed really well from that. So then you transfer them to your freezer bag. And when you go to cook these, The oven method would be on parchment paper, on a cookie sheet, in your oven.
You spray them with some olive oil first.
Spray them with some olive oil so they get nice and crispy. And then you want to bake them at 425 for 15 minutes. You can bake these from frozen, yes?
You can bake them from frozen. You add maybe 5 minutes to your cook time if you bake them from frozen. Or if you bake them thawed, then it's the 15 minutes.
Right. And then to eat them, you can dip them in salsa or sour cream or some guacamole. Now, for the air fryer, I haven't done them yet, but I'm going to try.
Yep.
And I would, so the air fryer seems to be, I'm still learning, right? There will be air fryer experts out there. Please tell us.
Chime in the comments.
In the comments if I am totally messing this up. But it seems to be similar to oven temperatures, but under. So the Brussels sprouts, we said in our recipe.
400
for 20-ish minutes.
Yeah.
20 to 25. I had Googled it. I just, you know, I didn't know how to make them in the air fryer. So I Googled it. I found a similar recipe. That wasn't as good as ours, but no, it told me how to cook it. And it was cook it at 380 for 18 to 20 minutes. And it was enough. So you would want to maybe plan, you know, if they're 15 minutes cooked, maybe you would want to cook them at 400 for 12 and check them.
Yeah.
You know?
And when Christy tests it out and then we put them in the club and all the things, then we'll know, we'll tell you the exact air fryer
times. Yeah. We'll have perfected it by
we're
then.
We're not there yet.
We have two test kitchens and the other one's at my house.
That's right. So we said that one of the reasons that we're doing this fill your freezer with hodgepodge things today is because I'm going on the ski trip. The other reason is actually because even though like a month and a half ago, we did a mega session.
Over 100 meals.
We'll put it there so that you can check that out if you want, because there's so many ideas there. And we can show you how you can make a lot of meals quickly. But usually that lasts us 3 months and we're totally set. This time, we kind of did, like, because the holidays were coming up, we even did a dessert, but we did some side dishes. We did side dishes for the holidays. We did our Christmas morning breakfast.
We did breakfast.
Stuff. And both of us ended up giving away quite a few of our meals. Mm-hmm. So it's not like we have no meals. And since then we have been making, like we made the video for the air fryer meals. Right. Christy was super excited to try out the air fryer. So it's not like
our cupboards are not bare.
Our freezers
we're
are not
starving.
Empty.
However,
but we're a little low, and so
we get panicky. It's happened where we've gotten low enough where we've dreamed about it.
Yeah, we're having nightmares.
We're having nightmares because there's not enough food in the freezer. Like it's a real security thing.
Because
right?
We never want to have to think about what to make for dinner ever again, because we've both been there, done that, decided we don't want to live like that anymore.
This is so much better. Come to our side. This is so much better.
Yeah.
So yes, like we said earlier, we saw these holes where, you know, I really did use the last of my Marry Me chicken last night. I almost used it in my air fryer, but I used my air fryer for the Brussels sprouts. So I'm like, now I need another air fryer. I know people who have two.
Now that's funny because you're like, no more kitchen appliances. And then it's like, do I need a second air fryer? What needs to happen is I need to get an air fryer so that for those of you who don't know, Christy lives two doors that way. So
we share back and forth a lot of stuff.
Things. Our kids run things back and forth all the time. I'm like, hey, do you have sour cream? Hey, you know, whatever.
Yeah, she's kept me in like tomato soup for like 10 years. We're good. That cup of sugar has gone back and forth so many times.
It sure has.
Yeah.
And our kids get their exercise. And
No, they're older now, so they want to drive.
They drive.
They drive the two houses down so that they can drive. Anyway.
Okay, so we did our big mega session thing, and if you watched that, you will know that there's a bit of a pork chop saga.
That's what we can call it. It's come to our attention that we don't really have a really great pork chop recipe in our club, and we're short on pork chops on the main site. And so we tried a new pork chop recipe, and it was bad.
Yeah, it failed.
And it failed.
We, you know, you guys occasionally have kitchen fails. We do too.
Yeah, and so we don't recommend making it. We did make it. It's in the video. We did not post the recipe. I mean, you could see us making it. You could probably try to copy it, but we're saying don't.
Don't do that.
So we are on the search for a pork chop recipe. Our Facebook group and in YouTube comments, people have been giving us recipes. We're going to try.
Keep them coming.
Keep them coming. We're not done.
We want to try more.
We're lacking in the pork chop department.
We're going to continue to find like multiple pork chop recipes. And today we are making a new to us pork chop recipe. We're going to give it a try and then we can report back. And again, it only makes it in the club if it makes the cut. So we'll see. But we're going to give that a try today. And we're not really sure what we're calling it yet. The name's a bit up in the air.
We'll have a decision by the time this airs, and I'm sure we'll come up with something.
You can check the description
below
for the recipes where there is actually a recipe.
No-name pork chops.
No-name pork chops.
No-name pork chops.
That might be their name.
That might end up being their name. Hey, we should have a naming contest.
Okay, in the comments, please
tell us what to
name the pork chops. That's a great idea.
I'm so full of them today.
That's
don't know why.
That's so good.
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay.
Okay, you can do a little graphic. Name the pork chop. I don't know.
So help us name our pork chop. Let us tell you what's in them first.
Start out with your pork chop. It could be bone in. It could be boneless. I don't think it's going to matter for the taste in this pork chop. It's going to be a preference. And this can be done in the oven or in the barbecue. And so we're going to start out with our pork chops right in the bag. We're going to add in a little bit of water and it's going to have just a nice marinade. It's a little bit of water, some soy sauce, some oil, lemon pepper seasoning, some garlic cloves, and some Montreal steak spice. I don't know if you know about how a marinade works. But a marinade must have oil, some sort of acid. So in this case, the soy sauce, I think, would stand in for an acid. Because lots of times it's vinegar or lemon juice.
Lemon pepper, maybe?
That's the spice. The third thing that it must have is a spice. So a marinade typically has those three things. I'm thinking it's the soy sauce. I somehow feel that it's probably more acidic than...
Sure. We'll
you know, it's not that. It's not sweet.
Nope.
So... That's, you know, general marinades. You can kind of conjure up any sort of marinade from what you have in your kitchen, but that's what they have. So this is a nice marinade. The lemon pepper and the Montreal steak spice are going to have nice marinating qualities. So as your pork chops defrost, they will marinate throughout that time in your fridge safely. Like
not
we do.
On your counter, no. Unsafely.
So on the day of cooking, you can do these under your broiler in your oven, which is a nice way to do it because they do tend to crisp up. And because if you do something like this in your pan, you know, there's not a lot of, there's no sugar in this. The soy sauce might burn a bit. Sometimes they burn, right? If it's a high sugar content. So the broiler is nice. The barbecue is nice. And pork is one. You want to make sure it's fully cooked, but just fully cooked. It's a tough one to cook because... Bam, they're overcooked and then they're a little bit tougher, they're a little bit dry, right? So the marinade will help with that. And use a meat thermometer. When we got our smoker, that was one of the things that I got because then it was reliable. I didn't have to guess and because I was getting into unfamiliar territory that, you know, stuff needed to be cooked. Ooh, this could go on the smoker. It'd be very good on the smoker.
You need to test it and see if it's good. And then you can use your smoker and test it. That's another thing that in the spring we might do a video of is like freezer meals for the smoker because Christy has a smoker. So Christy, with all her appliances.
And all my ideas. Why she keeps me around.
Okay, so.
Pork chop crisis averted, hopefully.
Hopefully.
Fingers crossed. And named.
Yes, thanks to you.
Crisis pork chops. Crisis pork chops. That'll sell.
Sorry. Okay.
No, we should stick with probably the contest. What do they win?
They win I don't know, the naming rights. They win the recognition. They win a shout out on our channel.
We could put their name in it. If I was entering a competition, I would call them Christie's Pork Chops.
But they didn't invent them.
Anytime, but they named them. They didn't invent a star, but they can name the star after them or a flower because they discovered it.
Right.
Anytime somebody, sorry, I'm really off my, I'm off. But anytime somebody says in the mom's group on Facebook is like, oh, I need little girl names. We've got the middle name. We just don't know the first name yet. Give me your girl name ideas. I always say my own name. Like, it's a really nice name. There was no reason. And then what can they say? Oh no, that's a terrible name. They always say, oh yeah, that's a really good.
What are they gonna say?
Whoa.
I never say my name, but I do put
I always see you put stuff in.
I put my girls' names in there because I think my girls have really pretty names.
They do.
They have like unique, but not. Well, actually, one is super unique, but
yeah, it really.
You know,
is.
Yeah. So. Yeah.
Yeah, I always put my own. I'm not that imaginative.
Your daughter's name is pretty, but it's not that unique. It's not unique.
It's not unique at all. But it's. Could you imagine her by any other name?
No, it's the perfect name for her.
Yeah, it really is.
Okay,
we have one more recipe. Hang in there.
Two more.
What? Okay. Oh, we do.
Okay, I know. You know us. We talk. I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry because it's way too much fun here. And why would we want to make it less fun? So, this is my kitchen. We'll talk
this is what we do. This is what we do here.
Okay.
Two more recipes.
We do some cooking too. more talking than cooking. Buttermilk waffles.
Yes. Oh, these they're good.
In the club. Oh, so good. Okay. I can't wait. Actually, when I said that the kids are going to put these in the toaster for breakfast, that's not entirely true. They are, but so am I. Let's be honest.
They're good.
I'm eating waffles on this trip too. Like,
yeah, of course.
Waffles, syrup, all kinds of healthiness. All right, so you're gonna take 4 cups of flour, 2 tablespoons of sugar, 1/2 teaspoon of salt, 4 tablespoons of baking powder, and you're going to whisk that all together, and then you're going to add 4 eggs that are lightly beaten, 2 2/3 cups buttermilk, 2 2/3 cups milk, and 1/2 cup of butter that's been melted. You're gonna mix that until it's just combined and then cook that in your waffle maker. Okay, I have a great waffle maker. It makes 4 waffles at a time. If you've been watching our videos for a really long time, then if you go back forever ago, I used to have a mini waffle maker and I would stand there all day. And I am not exaggerating.
This makes a lot of waffles.
This makes a lot of waffles. But because I want to use the whole buttermilk container,
You don't have 101 things to do with buttermilk?
No, I have a really good zucchini cake recipe with buttermilk. But
I bet you it's good.
Anyway, I would do this and more. And then I would stand there all day with this stupid little heart-shaped waffle maker, a mini one. And then I couldn't make it anymore because they got caught in my toaster and like started to almost start fires because they got stuck and flipped, like went down where it shouldn't go. Anyway, and then a friend told me about, thank you, Lindsay, for telling me about this waffle maker that I ordered from Amazon. The plates can go in the dishwasher, which is like very handy. And it makes 4 waffles at a time. So I don't stand there all day. And they are like bread size waffles. So they fit exactly in the toaster.
Does it make the 4 and then you break them apart?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's nice.
Yeah.
I'm so happy for you.
I will put the link for that into our Amazon store, which you can find in the description below, because I really like that. Okay, so here's the trick, though. Here's the key to making waffles for the freezer.
A little bit like the taquitos.
Is you gotta freeze them flat first on a cookie sheet. You want to wait for them to cool because you don't want your freezer to have to like
you don't want condensation
warm things and yeah condensation and all the you know all that you don't want to waste
you'll
energy
get crystals on them.
Yeah,
honestly, I think
so. You want to wait for them to cool and then you put them flat in your freezer. When they're frozen, you transfer them into freezer bags and then you take those with you on your ski trip, or you just keep them in your freezer and have them for breakfast.
Yes.
So there's that. Now, this next thing is like super random, but
today is the day. Where else are we going to put it?
I know. This is the hodgepodge video, so we might as well make, like, we've got pork chops.
We're going to make dessert now. Don't mind us.
Invent a soup and, you know, okay.
So we invented a soup.
No, just why not?
And I'm going to increase the birth rate of Christie's across North America.
Name your baby girls Christie.
Because they'll be fun like me.
Okay, and
get your recipe.
We are going to make apple crisp. Now, I'm not a desserts person. I don't love to eat dessert at all. I would way rather have appetizers, as I think we've established.
Yes.
And so because I don't like eating dessert, I'm not good at making desserts.
That makes sense, right?
Christy.
If you don't make them all the time.
Is awesome at making desserts. Like you make, well, the ones you do make, like your rhubarb flaps is amazing.
Oh, that's good.
And you've got
and
some
it
cakes that are
Maybe
so good.
Maybe we should do it next year.
And
the rhubarb's in.
Yes, we should.
Mm-hmm.
We should absolutely do rhubarb flats for a video. But the one thing that I can make is apple crisp.
And it's good. It's a good apple crisp.
It's a really good apple crisp.
And it freezes beautifully, right?
So,
yeah.
Here we go. You've asked for more desserts, and we deliver when you ask.
We're here to serve.
So, I'm going to put, like, a whole whack of apples. I don't measure, but
whatever fills your container.
Whatever fills my container. Now, you could do this in a 8x8 pan or in a 9x13 pan. We've got 7 kids, so I have never done it
in an 8x8. That would be mean.
That would be awful. And I think of all the things that I make in the world, the apple crisp that I make is probably my husband's absolute favorite. So I always make it in a 9x13. I like to use a few different kinds of apples. Because I find if then I have like the tart ones and the sweet ones,
it just
adds a bit of interest and just keeps things exciting.
So you mix your Granny Smith with your Macintosh. The Macintosh and the Spartan they're supposed to be considered the perfect cooking apple, apparently.
Mm, okay.
But the Granny Smith has that tartness
and a
little bit of crisp.
Yeah.
Right?
And I do Gala and Granny Smith.
Oh, nice.
So,
same idea.
You know?
Yeah.
So you're going to peel and slice your apples and put them down. So for the 9x13, that might end up being like 15-ish apples, or it might be like 12.
Depends
how big your apples are. So you just put them in the bottom of your tray. And then you're going to mix together in a bowl 1.5 cups of brown sugar, 1 cup of flour, 1.5 cups of rolled oats. I use like the old fashioned kind. 1 cup of butter that's melted and either cinnamon or apple pie spice.
Mm.
I usually use apple pie spice. And then you're gonna mix all of that together and then crumble it over top of your apples. Now, here's where it just differs a little bit for the freezing is you're going to put some plastic wrap right on top of it, like not so that it goes over and there's air, but like directly on top of your oats mixture. So there's no air because, again, we don't like air when we're freezer cooking because we don't want that freezer burn. Then you're going to cover it with foil. You're gonna make a note on the foil to remind yourself to take that plastic wrap off before you bake it, because we've both made that mistake before.
Yes, ma'am.
And so now we know that we always have to make a note on the foil. And then when you go to bake this, you can bake it from frozen or thawed. I prefer to bake it from frozen, and you're gonna bake it at 350 degrees. Now, if you're doing it from frozen, it can take up to an hour to cook, like 45 minutes at least, up to an hour. If you're doing it from thawed, then it's only about half an hour. And
you really just need the flour and the oats to cook through with the butter.
Totally.
And once your apples are soft, it's good.
Of course, you might want to serve it with ice cream because people do that.
Or on the farm, we would literally pour fresh cream on it.
Oh.
Yeah. Berries and cream or apple crisp and cream.
My husband would like that too.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing that I make even more often than I make apple crisp is Saskatoon crisp. I use the exact same topping.
Mm. Saskatoons are a little purple berry. Other parts of Canada might call them service berries.
Okay.
But in Saskatchewan, it's our next door neighboring province, there's a town, a city called Saskatoon. Hi, Anne-Marie. It's my maid of honor. Love her. She lives there. So Saskatoons, so they're a little bit bigger than a blueberry. Well, maybe about the size of a commercial blueberry.
Mm-hmm.
They're a little bit deeper of a purple, a little sweeter, and I don't know how to describe
the
flavor.
They're quite tart.
They'd be similar to a Hascap berry, if you've ever had that. They remind me a lot of each other and they look a little bit alike, except a Hascap is kind of elongated. But
they're my
if you're not familiar,
favorite berry.
They're a wonderful berry. We and they grow in the wild here. Like, it's a wonderful thing to have.
We have a bush in our yard or a tree. I don't know if it's called a Saskatoon bush. Saskatoon bush.
Yeah, I think so.
And we do have a video, actually, I'll put it there, on how to freeze Saskatoons or any berry.
Mm-hmm.
But specifically in that video, it's Saskatoons. And so you can see me picking them off
Aww. The
tree-ish thing and like how to wash them and freeze them and all the things. So I almost always have a bag or two or three of Saskatoons in my freezer, and I can super easily make Saskatoon crisp. Same topping, just Saskatoons instead of apples. You can also do Saskatoons and apples.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, very sadly,
oh,
I have run out.
Are you out?
I have run out and I don't have any more Saskatoons. So we are stuck with apple crisp.
Oh, the horror. I think that's a first world problem, but I feel for you because I too like Saskatoon crisp.
But and you've had mine. It's good.
I've had
right?
yours. Yeah, of course.
Of course.
Growing up, we had Saskatoon pie.
Oh, it's Saskatoon and rhubarb Saskatoon pie. Like
strawberry rhubarb.
I don't even like pie. But so
but
actually, I take the pie crust off. But
oh, you're so
eat
funny.
The
Pfeifendeckel.
Yes.
Has a very nice Saskatoon sour cream pie.
Weird.
They have a lot of sour cream pies.
That is weird.
We should go on a field trip.
Ooh, Pfeifendeckel field trip.
Here we come.
Okay, so, Pfeifendeckel is like a pie shop.
Yeah, soup and sandwiches. They do catering, but you can order your pies there. I've ordered them for Thanksgiving before. If I wasn't feeling up for making pie, I just ordered like 3 or 4 from Pfeifendeckel.
And they taste homemade.
They taste homemade. They're amazing. It used to be right by one of the places I worked, so we would get them all the time. And then because it was an engineering firm on Pi Day, which is March 14th, 3.14, we would get engineering pies that they would put a little pie cut into it and bake them for us because we were nerds. It was an engineering firm. It was fine. And they did it for us. It was nice.
That's so great.
It was
Pi
Day. So funny.
Oh, we could do pie video on Pi Day. Oh, I'm getting ahead of myself. That's all the way in March.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I think we had fun today.
We had a lot of fun today, and we got a lot done.
And my freezer is going to feel better. I'm going to feel better about my freezer. I wasn't to the dreaming part yet, but we had both commented, you know, I'm getting a little low.
I'm definitely low still on side dishes.
Yeah.
So maybe we should do a side dish video one of these times and kind of get stocked up on the side dishes. Because like you were saying last night, you had the Marry Me chicken and mashed potatoes and
right.
And you can just take it all out.
Yes.
But you know, I don't, right now I have a lot of like chickens and marinades or that kind
of
thing.
And all my chicken and marinades are gone.
Oh, isn't that funny?
Because we eat so many, my husband really likes potatoes. He would rather eat a potato before he ever eats rice or pasta ever again.
Right.
And so that was specifically why we did some of the chicken marinades.
Yep.
But it's so that it goes nicely with the potato. We're making something that's got a really nice pasta sauce. It feels kind of dumb to make it with a potato.
Yeah.
Or something that's Asian inspired.
Yeah, you can have it with rice.
It's dumb to make it with a potato. So
unless you're her husband, yeah.
Yeah, so all of that kind of stuff is gone. So yes, more marinades. The pork chops, they're gonna be so perfect to go with the potatoes.
Potatoes. So you can probably expect maybe a side dish video and maybe some more chicken coming.
Some more marinades. No, you have lots, so we'll figure it out.
Thank you for joining us today.
Oh, it was a mishmash of a video. We were a mishmash today.
But it's been fun, and it's always more fun with you guys here. So,
we'll see you
happy
next
cooking.
Time. Don't forget to name those pork chops.